even kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare His praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. For our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. Our God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion. Come on, let's sing this out in faith. Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Yeah, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Yeah, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Or who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's warring with power and fighting our battles, and every face down, and we worship, we all cry out. You are worthy, God. You are worthy, God. We crown you. We fall face down and we worship. We all cry out. You are worthy, God. You are worthy. Upon himself all our guilt and shame, hanging on a cross for the world. He loved with his precious blood, purchased men for God.
Yeah. So give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Lord, give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to bend our knees. Oh Spirit, come make us whole. We turn our eyes from evil things. Oh Lord, we cast down
out together. Sing, Christ is my reward.
Oh, Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial my soul will sing, no turning back. I've been set free.
Come on, let's sing this out.
Sing, Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. And everything I need is in. Lord, everything I need. Oh, Christ, my all in all, the joy of my salvation. our home.
Yes, it is.
Through every storm, my soul will sing. Jesus is here. To God be the glory. And Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Oh, everything I need is in you. Everything I need is in Christ. Oh, Christ.
Jesus, you are the way, the truth, and the life. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen, church. Well, hey, good morning, and we're really glad you're here. Before you take a seat, would you say hi to somebody next to you, get their name, commit to praying for them, and we'll have some announcements on the screen. God bless.
Hey everyone, we're so glad that you joined us today as we worship God and study His Word. We want to make sure you're aware of a couple ways that you can give here at the church. You can always text to give, you can give online at calvaryCCH.org, and then of course there are the agape boxes located in the back of the sanctuary. We also want to let you know about a need regarding our alms pantry. This is a pantry that we are able to give food to families in need, and it's in need of some restocking. And so if you'd be willing to go shopping and restock some of those items, in the courtyard today at a table, we have a shopping list that can give you the appropriate items needed. We also want to make sure that you are aware of the upcoming conference, Answer the Call conference, coming up in mid-May. We'd encourage you to sign up online and make sure you are registered. Now, in addition to that, we are excited because Youth Ministry is going to be partnering with Liberty Ed for an epic trip called the Science Adventure. And so we have Dr. Austin here to give us all the details.
And you're going to want to hear this, you guys. We have a great trip coming. Our youth, we're going to take a select group, so make sure you listen very carefully. We're going to fly all the way to Dallas and visit the Institute of Creation Research. And yes, we're going to bus back and visit three different national parks, learning about all God has to offer with our creation. It's going to be an epic trip. And with that, we have a mandatory meeting April 28th at 3 p.m. for all families who are interested in participating in the science adventure. You're not gonna wanna miss it. We'll see you there. We also have an established ministry meeting April 23rd at 7 p.m. here at the church. We're gonna be covering the topic of how to homeschool your high schooler. Join us as Carrie DeFrancisco shares all about it. Now, here are some more announcements.
Real Impact would like to invite you to our next Parents Forum taking place Tuesday, April 23rd at 7 p.m. We'll be joined by Leandra Blades, a member of the Placentia Yorba Linda Unified School District Board of Education. She's going to talk about what it takes to add an item onto a Board of Education meeting agenda, as well as dive into her experience as a school board candidate, as well as her experiences as a sitting board member. We'd like to let you know that this event is free and childcare will be provided. However, registration is required for attendance. For registration and more information, you can visit realimpact.us. We hope to see you there.
And the book of the month for April is Barry McGuire's Ignite Your Life. This is a book that will truly change the way that you live. And so we'd encourage you to get your hands on a copy at the bookstore or on jackhibbs.com. Now, there's a lot happening. We don't want you to miss out. And so go to the website, calvaryCCH.org. All the information is there, all the dates and the times and everything you need to know, or download the church app. Now, let's take a moment for a word from our pastor.
Well, hey, everybody. Obviously, Pastor Jack here, and I am currently not with you guys. In a moment, I'm going to be introducing our guest speaker for today that you are going to want to hear from. But I had speaking commitments, and I know that I had been telling you for the last week and a half that what is now happening has in fact now begun, and that is Iran's attack against Israel. And I can say a few things without compromising sources. We know that there have been numerous, and I'm quoting right now, Pastor Jack, it's crazy over our skies here. There are various fighter jets from various countries trying to shoot down the Iranian missiles, and there may be other missiles that are here over Israel. That's an interesting comment from somebody who's there. On top of it is Israel has said just moments ago that Iran will experience an earthquake that will be felt throughout the entire country. We don't know what that means, but that is a quote. We don't know what that means, but that is a quote. Iran has initiated the attack. If this is Ezekiel 38, friends, you know, church, I've been asking you for months to read Ezekiel chapter 38. This could very well be that unfolding of that very thing. We shall see. If it is, then we are going to expect Russia to eventually have to get involved. And I say have to get involved because Ezekiel says that the prince of Rosh, Meshach, and Tubal, his title is Gog, G-O-G. God says, I'm going to put hooks into your jaws, turn you around, and pull you down from the uttermost parts of the north, and you will come with the other armies to invade Israel. And in that moment, God says, then I will arise and I will defend Israel. So I'm not asking all of you to believe this. I'm asking all of you to watch this with Bible open, test it and see. This could calm down and the Ezekiel battle does not unfold. Or this could be the start of a third world war. But as I sit here tonight, I'm in Knoxville, Tennessee, Saturday night. We just got done with church services here, and I'm doing church services tomorrow, and I'll be back with you guys on Wednesday. But this is a very critical moment, and I would have loved to have been there with all of you, because for people like me, we've been studying what could be unfolding all of our Christian lives. So everybody, keep your eye on the news. And this is an epic moment. Pray for the peace and for the protection and for the salvation of all of Israel as we are commanded. And boy, it's been a busy day. Spoke with a senior news correspondent from Jerusalem, and they were in their bunker. They were in their bomb shelter, as are the Israelis. And they're ready for this. And it's very, very clear to them that they are not going to not respond. So listen, I'm doing this late tonight, East Coast time. By the time this is seen by you, many things could have changed. But it's going to be what we call an all-nighter, because the news, it's now daylight in the Middle East. This thing is unfolding fast. And I hope you know the Lord Jesus Christ. I hope you're trusting in Jesus for your salvation. If you're not a Christian, stop goofing off. It's time for you to get serious with God, because he loves you. And everything that we're talking about has revealed in Scripture so that you might believe. And so I'll keep you updated on social media. I'll see you in person next Wednesday night. And we may very well, of course, do a prophecy teaching on Wednesday night. We'll make more of an announcement as well. But now I'm going to go with a regularly scheduled video announcement of a very dear brother and friend. I'll see you soon, church. God bless you.
This brother, in a moment, you're going to realize, needs no introduction. But he's my lifelong battle buddy in our Christian experience, in our Christian journey. That means that he and I are joined at the hip and joined at the heart. We have committed ourselves one to another in prayer and keeping in touch with one another, checking on one another. Why? For a lot of reasons. One of them is we both love the Lord Jesus. The second thing is God has blessed us with a warrior spirit. But the third thing also is this, that we love our country that God has given us. And if I might throw a fourth thing in there, this man loves the church and he loves this church. I'm talking about the president of the Family Research Council, my good friend, Tony Perkins.
Well, good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is great to be at my home church on the left coast. I saw somewhere between Chino Hills, California, and Knoxville, Tennessee, that Pastor Jack found a razor. You are indeed blessed with a wonderful pastor. He is my battle buddy, as he made reference to. And I so appreciate Pastor Jack. And I want to again challenge you to be praying for him and Lisa, praying for them. You know, Pastor Jack, what I like about him, he's courageous, he's bold, he will preach the word of God. I mean, he's the kind of guy that would walk up into a group of a gang of Hell's Angels and say, you need to take a bath. I mean, he's unafraid. And that's what we need. We need to boldly proclaim the word of God. Now, I am a little disappointed. He invited me to come out here to sunny California. And so yesterday I was sitting outside trying to get my vitamin D, and it wasn't happening, but I was identifying as someone getting sun. Okay? Now, it's actually been a couple years since I've been here almost, and so I'm sure there are a lot of new folks here. How many of you are new in the last 2 years? All right, there's a few of you. Okay, great. I know that everywhere I go across the country when I speak, people say, you know Pastor Jack Hibbs? I say, yeah, I know Pastor Jack. They're watching online because, you know, this is the silver lining of COVID, as people began to look and watch online and find pastors like Pastor Jack, Gary Hamrick, and others who are preaching the Word of God. And so we welcome our online audience from across the country. But for those of you that may be new, you're wondering about a guy from Washington coming here to speak this morning. And I know you wouldn't want to play golf because out there where it was nice and cloudy this morning. But you think, well, I could have stayed home. Let me just give you this quick disclaimer that others may be aware of. Long before I thought of politics, the Lord actually called me to preach. I've been preaching since I was 15. Now, he called me to preach in nursing homes. Little did I know that that was preparation to work with Congress. I have found that both crowds are hard of hearing and slow of moving. Before I get into today's message, which is very timely, I think, for where we are, I want to talk about what is happening right now in Israel in the Middle East. With Iran launching 185 drones yesterday, 36 cruise missiles, 110 surface-to-surface missiles, in what was an unprecedented attack on Israel. And once again, we are reminded that we live in times of great uncertainty, both abroad and here at home. But we've been given clear instruction on how we as followers of Jesus Christ are to respond. And we're to stand firm in the truth of God. You know, Jesus warned us that these days would be coming. In John chapter 15, he says, "These things I have spoken to you." He warned his followers. He said, I have spoken these things to you that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. God does not want us to be anxious. He does not want us to be worrying about this. He wants us to go to work. This is the moment for the church to walk in its full authority. In John chapter 14, he says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." You know, God intends for you and I to have peace and joy, even as it appears the world is spinning out of control. In reality, everything is falling into place. And I was in Israel about 3 weeks ago. We went to some of the sites of the greatest atrocities committed by Hamas. I talked to survivors. I met with family members of those who are still being held hostage. I also met with Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu for about an hour. And my trip came between President Biden's State of the Union address, where he was caught with this off-mic comment saying Netanyahu needed a come-to-Jesus meeting, and Chuck Schumer calling for the dissolving of the Israeli government in the middle of a war. And this is the greatest threat that this nation of Israel has seen since its founding almost 76 years ago. Well, as our meeting with the prime minister, and he was explaining exactly what we see unfolding, he said, if we are not decisive in our victory against Hamas, he said, it's going to incite Iran directly to attack us. And of course, we've seen our administration vacillating back and forth. And I believe what happened yesterday was the result of the Biden administration vacillating back and forth in its support of Israel. So at the end of our meeting with the prime minister, it was about to end, I asked him if I could pray for him. He said, sure. He said, so I prayed, and as I prayed for him and his cabinet and prayed over him, I said, and I pray all these things in Jesus' name. And there was a long, silent pause. And then the prime minister said, well, President Biden said I needed to come to Jesus' meeting. I guess that was it. But he asked that we, and I told him, I said, you know, we stand with you because we're people of the book. And Genesis 12 says, those who bless you will be blessed, and I want a blessing, and I want our nation to be blessed. And I believe America's future, you see, Israel has a future. We know they have a future. I'm not so sure about America as we have walked away from God in every way. And I believe the only reason that America continues is because we have stood with Israel. And if we depart from that commitment of standing with Israel, I fear for my country's future. And so he asked, he said, well, we need visible support. Can you get churches and can you get others to stand visibly with Israel? And I said, Mr. Prime Minister, I'll do my very best. And so working with Pastor Jack and other pastors, we are declaring Sunday, May the 19th, Pray For and Stand with Israel Sunday. And our goal is to have churches all across the nation praying for Israel on that Sunday and standing with Israel. And if you'd like to actually sign the pledge, you can text Israel to 67742 that you will pray for and stand with Israel. And we're hoping to see churches all across this nation standing with Israel. And here's something we need to remember. While we may not have the political authority to negotiate and to make decisions for our government, although we have, I spent a good bit of time yesterday on the phone with the House Speaker, Mike Johnson, discussing this issue. And you may see he released a very strong statement because 4 months ago, the House sent over funding for Israel that Chuck Schumer has been sitting on for 4 months, refusing to advance. In fact, the House Speaker invited the Prime Minister to come and speak at a joint session of Congress over 2 weeks ago. But because it's a joint session, Chuck Schumer is blocking that. So we have an administration that is vacillating between supporting those who support Hamas and standing with a strategic political ally, but more importantly, a spiritually significant ally. But as believers, we have been given the keys of the kingdom. And we need to exercise those keys. We need to bind those voices that would speak into this administration, that would cause them to move from their support of Israel. And we need to loose that support that Israel needs in this hour to have a definitive victory. And we need to pray that God would show himself mighty to save. In fact, I want to ask you right now to join me and let's pray for Israel and for our leaders. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, the name that is above every name. And we lift up Israel to you right now. I lift up the Prime Minister, Benjamin Netanyahu. I pray for great wisdom for him and for his cabinet. And we pray for divine protection. Lord, we're grateful and thankful that 99% of those drones and those missiles were shot down before they hit their targets. And we pray, Father, that this would cease, that there would be peace over all, every inch of Israel. But Lord, I pray that there would be a definitive manifestation of your presence and your power that would cause the world to take note that you are God and you alone. As the psalmist wrote in Psalm 68, let God arise, let his enemies be scattered, let those who hate him flee before him. Father, we pray for this world right now that appears to be spinning out of control, but Lord, the pieces are just falling into place. And I pray for America that, Lord, we would, our leadership, even if they've are moving in the wrong direction, Lord, you turn the hearts of kings as you do the rivers of waters. Turn their heart to stand with Israel. Lord, we bind those voices that would speak against standing with Israel, and we loose the freedom and the strength and the resources that need to flow to Israel from the United States of America. Lord, we pray the church would arise in this hour, obedient to Scripture, standing with Israel and with the Jewish people. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, when we look at all that is going on, the word is very clear in Scripture as to how we should respond. We are to stand firm, unshaken, undeterred, with courage, with boldness, and strength. There was a recent report by Security Gauge. It was a crime risk assessment platform, and they collate data on violent crime here in the United States. And they came out with their 10 most dangerous cities in the United States. Number one on the list was Bessemer, Alabama, followed by Monroe, Louisiana, which is actually in my home state. And tied for third was Memphis, Tennessee. And there was a local resident of Memphis that was being interviewed about the violence in the city by the local television station. I want you to turn your attention to the screen and watch this interview.
Well, we report about the city's crime problem almost every day. But today, that problem hit home for one of our crews while doing a story about crime in Whitehaven. We were interviewing a woman about the Memphis PD's plan to enforce the city's teen curfew when out of nowhere, a drive-by shooting across the street. Watch.
Gotcha. Can you spell your name for me?
My name is Yolanda, Y-O-L-A-N-D-A.
Get down. Just stay down and get down. That's okay. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Just stay down and get down. It's no, they're coming back.
Okay.
You okay, Jay? Thank you, Lord, for the blood of Jesus that cover us. Thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
All right. We should be all right. Bye-bye. Yep. You saw it, the black car.
The woman was comforting this male reporter. I assume I couldn't see it, but I guess he was trying to crawl under the car. She was assuring him it was going to be okay. Why? Because the blood of Jesus. According to the Word of God, this is what the church should be doing in this hour of uncertainty. We are pleading the blood of Jesus. There's no reason. It's all right. It's all right, Jake. It's going to be okay. Because the blood of Jesus. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, Paul, in his letter, is telling believers in Thessalonica that there were some challenges ahead. He was being very honest, just as Jesus did. You know, I'm disturbed by some of the churches today that, you know, they call people to follow Christ as if it's going to be a picnic. It's not going to be a picnic. Jesus said, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. It is going to, you don't take up a cross. That's not, they were talking about the latest jewelry. It's talking about an instrument of death. We need to be, Paul was warning, there's going to be some difficult challenges ahead, but here, don't be shaken. Don't be deceived. Rather, stand firm. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. As we take a look at this, Paul, he had written his first letter, and there had been either some distortion or misunderstanding. Some thought that Christ had already come, that and so he had to explain to them that the end wasn't yet, that because what was happening is you had one group that had they were literally a basket case because they were violently shaken in their minds. They couldn't even work. They were walking away from their responsibility. And Paul had to correct these behaviors because they were hindering the work and the witness of the church. So in this chapter, Paul lays out what will happen before the end when the Lord Jesus Christ returns to the earth and he sits in judgment. So beginning in verse 1 of chapter 2 of Thessalonians. Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in your mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first. And the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God and that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they would believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks to God always for you, brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God from the beginning chose you for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth, to which he called you by our gospel, for the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which you were taught, whether by word or by our epistle. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and our God and Father, who has loved us and given us everlasting consolation and good hope by grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. It is your word that we look to for guidance and for direction. And we pray for the Holy Spirit, who is our teacher, to lead us into all understanding of your word. Lord, we live in tumultuous times, times filled with trouble and uncertainty, but you have told us that these times were coming, and you warned us, and you've given us your word so that we might have peace and joy even in the midst of this. This morning I pray the Holy Spirit, we invite the Holy Spirit to come and to do what only the Holy Spirit can do by taking your word and changing us. I pray for any who are here this morning that do not know you as Lord and Savior, that, Lord, I bind every distraction in the name of Jesus, that they might hear the truth and respond in obedience to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. In the day of spiritual apostasy, lawlessness, and the abandonment of truth, how are followers of Jesus Christ to stand firm? Well, Paul provides the answer to that question in this passage, but let's first look at what Paul says believers are going to encounter in those days leading up to the end times, which, frankly, I believe we're in. I mean, when you look at what is happening, you read the headlines, you read the scripture, I believe we are in those times. The first is, there is going to be this great apostasy. He says, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless a falling away comes first. What does it mean by an apostasy? Well, there's a departure from the faith. And I believe we're seeing this today. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, it says, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth." I mean, have you noticed that it's, you know, not eating certain foods has almost become a way to virtue signal? I mean, it's become a form of religion. But he goes on to say, "For every creature of God is good, and nothing is to be refused if it is received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer." You know, I don't want to shock you, but I am a member of PETA. Yeah, it's people eating tasty animals. The word says, if you're thankful for it, it's good. You know, an example of this apostasy, this falling away, is the deconstruction that we've watched from many Christian celebrities. Have you noticed that? They've announced that they're deconstructing their faith. Well, I was reading a few stories, and I ran across this one. And I'm actually going to read from, this was an article that was posted by a young Christian woman, or previously Christian woman. She says, "The spark that began my Christian deconstruction," she goes on to say, "my own journey of deconstruction began well before I was aware of it. As a high schooler on various social media sites like Tumblr and MySpace, and surrounded by peers coming from backgrounds and walks of life completely foreign to me, I began to see that my worldview was much too narrow to encompass so much of life." Now, as I was reading that, it seemed to me that Jesus said something in Matthew 7 about a narrow gate. You know, some people, they're so open-minded, their brains have fallen out. We are to choose the narrow way. Continuing with her letter, what really got my attention was the multiple friends and acquaintances throughout those 4 years who embraced gender identities and sexualities much different from what I had been brought up to understand. As I continued into college and even beyond, I realized that I myself may not be who I thought I once was. I am now at a place in my journey where spirituality isn't urgent to me anymore. I am no longer in a race against time to save every non-Christian person I know. And that's the end of her letter. It's very interesting to me how sexual identity is a factor in so many of these deconstruction experiences. Is it the Bible doesn't conform to what we think we want, so there is a defection, a walking away from the faith, and a deconstruction. Deconstructionism is an attempt to justify the falling away. And so we're seeing this clash of worldviews, and either the Word of God is authoritative or it is not. And this is not like a cafeteria smorgasbord where you can pick and choose what you want. This is the Word of God. And I know many parents are struggling with this, and grandparents, as their children infected by the contagion on social media are becoming confused about their sexual identity. Well, there's just a report released this last week, a case report. It's called CASS case. It was the researcher that did this, looking at all of the studies on gender identity and the treatments that are out there, and said that all of this is basically false. This idea that we've got to intervene with children when they're having confusion about their sexual identity, that we need to start hormone blockers or we need to go to surgeries, that's all based on false science. Well, we could have told you that. God made them male and female. And you don't have to choose between your children and grandchildren in the Word of God. You love them and you bring them to the Word of God and you affirm them how God created them to be. You know, before all this deconstructionism became a fad, Ken Ham, founder of Answers in Genesis, wrote a book probably almost 20 years ago entitled Already Gone. Now, the book's premise counters the prevalent idea that young people lose their faith when they go off to college. He said that their faith was already gone. See, Bible stories will not sustain you in the storms of life. Only biblical truth can do that. You know, we need to be teaching our children biblical truth, not Bible stories, because their faith is already gone when they go off to college. We have to give them a solid foundation in the Word of God. You know, but it doesn't stop with the departure from faith. I mean, you know, people can walk away from their faith, but that void is going to be filled with something. Some of you probably remember the old Bob Dylan song, "You're going to have to serve somebody." It may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're going to have to serve somebody. The reality is there is no spiritual neutrality. You know, some people say, well, you know, I'm kind of like in the middle of the road. I'm not for that or for that. Jesus said, if you're not for me, you're against me. Either you're working with us or you're scattering. There is no spiritual neutrality. It's interesting, the new atheist Richard Dawkins essentially admitted this in an interview on Easter Sunday morning. Dawkins, who has spent much of his life driving Christianity from the public square, acknowledges that cultural Christianity is good for society. He welcomes the fruit of Christianity, but not the truth. He's lamenting the demise of the Christian culture because that void is being filled by evil forces. But here's the reality. You can't have the fruit of Christianity without the truth of Christianity. There is no moral neutrality. If you push the church out, it will be filled with something else. And his concern is he's seeing in the UK as it's being filled with Islam. The path of departure from truth then leads to a devotion to deceiving spirits. Now, Jesus warned of this in Mark chapter 13, verse 5. And Jesus answered them. He began to say, "Take heed that no one deceives you." See, multiple times as Jesus was talking about the end times and what was going to be coming into place, he warns against deception. In verse 23 of Mark 13, "But take heed, see, I have told you these things beforehand." So what form does this deception come in? Well, number one, Scripture says that it comes in the doctrine of demons. In James chapter 3, verse 15, "This wisdom does not descend from above, but it is earthly, sensual, and demonic." It is what is being taught to our children is the indoctrination that is taking place. This is the doctrine of demons. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13, "For such are false prophets, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no wonder. For Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works." We live in a day where discernment is so needed. This is why we must pray and we must be in the Word of God. We must be tethered to the truth. And if you are not, and this is why I'm so grateful for Pastor Jack, because he preaches from the Word. But what would you do if you just ate one meal a week? Yeah, you wouldn't be too healthy. The same is true for the Word of God. You need to be in God's Word each and every day. You know, people ask me all the time, "Tony, how do you survive in Washington? How do you deal with those people?" I'm in the Word of God every morning. And it explains it. I mean, we're seeing, as Pastor Jack said, we're watching history that was prophesied years ago, unfolding before us. And so the Word of God gives instruction to us. It gives encouragement to us. And it says, "Be anxious for nothing, but by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God." Have anxiety? Here's the prescription. It's the Word of God. And if you don't have, I don't want to take anybody away from a Bible reading plan, but if you don't have a reading plan, I have one for you. We have a 2-year journey through the Bible called Stand on the Word. And I don't know if any of you or anybody here on that. We've got a few. Well, I invite you to join us on this journey. It takes about 10 to 15 minutes every morning or anytime during the day. But I also do a video devotional every morning, 10 to 15 minutes, walking through the Word and applying it to our lives, just as Pastor Jack teaches. And I just find it is the people that are on this in these days find joy, encouragement, strength, and direction from the Word of God. So if you're if you'd like to join us, simply text Bible to 67742 and you can join us on our journey. In fact, we're just starting the book of Joshua. Well, the great apostasy, this turning away from God, is paving the way for the great revolt. In verse 6, 2 Thessalonians 2, "And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time, for the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders." So we're seeing the spirit of the lawless one being revealed. What we see is that the lawless one opposes God. He puts himself in the place of God above all that is called God. The lawless one is the Antichrist and will be the great political and spiritual leader that will bring about this conflict. He will war against heaven himself. So as we move toward this point in history, which I believe we're moving into, we must expect greater political and spiritual conflict and spiritual warfare, which we're already seeing today. Let me read you the proclamation from the White House issued on Easter Sunday. "On Transgender Visibility Day of Visibility, we honor the extraordinary courage and contributions of transgender Americans and reaffirm our nation's commitment to forming a more perfect union where all people are created equal and treated equally throughout their lives." Now, when people began to criticize the White House about this on Easter Sunday, the media came to their defense and said, well, it just so happened that March 31st was Easter, and for the last 3 years, March 31st has been Transgender Visibility Awareness Day. Okay. Resurrection Sunday has only been celebrated for 2,000 years. It shows the priorities of this administration, but they are putting themselves above God in the agenda that they are promoting. Now, notice in the White House statement that God's actually left out as they paraphrase the declaration, "All people are created equal, treated equally throughout their lives." Created by whom? They're created by God, as our founders said. This stuff doesn't just happen. This is intentional. We are seeing the manifestation of the lawlessness and the rejection of God as the authority over mankind. Now, I don't think he realizes it. I don't think the depth of the truth that he is speaking. But President Biden has been making some statements. Again, I'm not sure he knows what he's saying, but he is speaking truth. I want you to watch this clip.
"This campaign isn't just about winning votes. It's about winning the heart and, yes, the soul of America.
To overcome these challenges, to restore the soul and secure the future of America requires so much more than words.
A reminder that we remain in an ongoing battle for the soul of America.
I ran for president because I believe we're in a battle for the soul of this nation.
We remain in the battle for the soul of our nation. When I look around at all of you here today, I know we'll win that battle.
What is already given to God, he cannot take. We are in a battle for the heart and soul of America. But it's beyond that. It's the battle for the souls of our children. That last clip was actually at the White House in a celebration with children around him of transgenderism. There is a battle raging, and if we do not awaken to that understanding as the church, we will not prevail in this battle. There is a battle raging for the heart and soul of America, which is the future. And we must realize it and start using the spiritual weapons that the Lord has provided. Now, let me be very clear about this. Paul says that we do not war against flesh and blood. All right, we're not in a spirit. We're not going to, this is not going to be a physical competition. I am not advocating for that. We are in a spiritual battle, and we need to use our spiritual weapons. What are our weapons? Number one, the Word of God. We need to know the Word of God. When I was in the Marine Corps, I can still do it today. I spent 40 years ago. I can still take my M16 apart, blindfold it, and put all the pieces back together. Because I spend so much time with it. How many Christians have that knowledge of the Word of God, which is our weapon? This is our sword. We need to know how to use it, and we need to know it. We need to be in it. Prayer. We need to be praying. We need to be constantly in prayer. We need to fast. Now that's a spiritual weapon. I know it's not a popular one, but you know it's you should try this sometime. Invite some friends over for a fast. You know it's it's cheaper and easier than fixing dinner. Praise and worship. We need to be praising and worshiping God, and then our testimony is a weapon. Do not be afraid to share what God has done in your life. Share it at work. Share it in the neighborhood. Everywhere you have an opportunity, tell your story. The world is about hearing people's stories. Well, your story is just as valid and valuable as anyone else's. So tell your story. Give your testimony. It is a powerful, powerful weapon in this spiritual battle. Well, the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Verse 7 says, for the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. The Antichrist is not here yet that we know of, but the stage is being set. He's not been revealed. So restraining lawlessness, what is restraining lawlessness? I'd say right now, not a whole lot. There is some debate among scholars as to what Paul was referring to when he talks about this one who is restraining. Some scholars suggest civil government rooted in the moral law of God, while others say it is the church and the Holy Spirit that is restraining. Frankly, I do not see the two in conflict, but rather in concert. It is the presence of the church, individual believers, in which the Holy Spirit dwells, the presence of which shapes and informs government. And not just civil government, but self-government, family government, and church government. When aligned with God's word and will, these God-ordained institutions restrain evil. But as we see today, lawlessness advances as faith and obedience to God recedes. Each one of us, living in obedience to God's word, restrains evil. Each one of us, we have a responsibility to restrain lawlessness. I don't do this very often, but I went into a Walmart a few months ago with my wife. We had to duck in, and there's a couple reasons. Like I don't like going into Walmart, but it takes me forever to get in, especially at home. I go in and I'll see all kinds of people, so we end up speaking, you know, talking a lot, which I like, but it's just if you're in a hurry, it's hard. But we were walking down an aisle, and I saw a mother with three small children, probably ages 8 to 5, and the littlest one was a boy, and he was kind of trailing behind all the others, and apparently he was doing something he wasn't supposed to, and his mother corrected him, and this is what she said, and it almost caused me to drop my tortilla chips. She said, where is your self-government? Exercise your self-government. And I'm thinking, what profound insight. That is what restrains lawlessness. If we're teaching our five-year-olds to exercise self-government, guess what? We don't need as much civil government that will have to track them down and incarcerate them later. You know, civil government should be restraining evil, but we now have a government that is promoting lawlessness. Church, through the presence of the Holy Spirit, has the keys to bind and to loose. We need to use the authority that we have. I'm challenging churches to, in areas where they have lots of crime, is to go out and pray and bind those demonic forces that are at work. Look, and I know this is fine at Pastor Jack's church. Some churches, the place would immediately vacate by saying this. Satan is real. And his demonic forces, principalities, powers, and rulers of darkness of this age and spiritual host of wickedness in heavenly places are working. And they're affecting the outcome of what is happening in our communities. We have authority over them in the name of Jesus. We need to exercise that authority. I mean, think about it. Do you think it was coincidence in 2020 when the churches were closed across the country because of COVID that the tide of lawlessness rose across the country and frankly is yet to recede? There's a connection. The presence of the church restrains lawlessness. And then let's look at the results of apostasy. 2 Timothy chapter 3, but know this, that in the last days perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, and from such people turn away. This is why we must pray. And this is why we must vote. We must vote those in office who will stand on biblical truth. Because the great revolt will lead to the great delusion. In verse 9, the coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe in the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. They rejected the truth. Jesus, the Word of God, is the truth. And what happens when you reject the truth? Well, you receive the delusion. And for this reason, God will send them a strong delusion and they should believe the lie. The big lie is not about the 2020 election. The big lie is about the usurpation of God, His Word, and His authority. In Romans chapter 1, verse 24, therefore God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. The big lie is that we as human beings define truth when in reality truth is the foundation of the world established by God. The big lie is that we can determine our own gender when it is God who made us male and female. The big lie is the claim that we are God and He is not. That is the big lie. How do we keep in this day and age from being deceived? It's the Word of God. We must stand firm on truth. Verse 15 says, therefore, brethren, stand firm and hold the traditions or the teachings, the doctrine which you were taught, whether by word or our epistle. The truth of God's word, it's God's word that inoculates us against the virus of deception. What's out there on social media, what's on the legacy media, we need to be inoculated to the virus of deception by being in the Word of God. So in the day of spiritual apostasy, lawlessness, and abandonment of truth, how are we as followers of Jesus Christ to stand firm? Here it is. Pray. Hold to the Word of God. Therefore, brethren, stand fast, stand firm, and hold the traditions, the doctrine which you were taught, whether by word or by epistle. In Mark chapter 13, verse 33, take heed, watch and pray, for you do not know when the time is. We don't know the date, we know the season, and we know how to prepare. We need to pray, and we need to stand on God's word. And then we need to vote, we need to engage, we need to spread the gospel, we need to influence the world around us. Verse 16, now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and our God and Father establish you in every good word and work. You see, it's not enough to have the faith. It's not enough to have our own understanding and faith in God. We have to act on that faith, because faith without works is dead. Jesus said in Matthew 5 that you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? You and I are the salt. We are the light. We have to engage the culture around us, but we have to first be in the Word and standing on the Word of God. And then finally, when everything is said and done, we must continue to stand. There is no despiritualized zone. There is no middle ground. We are either for the Lord or we are against Him. And He is calling us to stand upon and for the truth. Therefore, brethren, stand fast, persevere, and hold the traditions that you were taught, whether by word or by our epistle. In Ephesians 6, verse 13, therefore take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness. One of my many kind of heroes of history is John Quincy Adams, one of America's greatest diplomats. John Quincy Adams only served one term in office, but he did something that no other president has ever done before. After serving as president, and he was a Puritan, he was a little too conservative, and he just didn't play politics, and so he didn't get a second term. But he ran for Congress after serving president. Only president's ever done this. And the reason he did is because he wanted to end slavery in America. He saw that it was a scourge on America, and that this was not going to end well for America. And so he ran for Congress and served in Congress for almost 20 years. And he would bring up this issue of slavery so often that they actually passed a rule in the Congress in 1836 called the gag rule. They passed this rule that you could not bring up the word slavery on the House floor. And so the cancel culture is not new. Those that cannot defend their positions want to cancel the truth and silence it. And so there was a reporter came up to Mr. Adams, and probably a CNN reporter, I don't know, said, Mr. Adams, you've lost. You've dedicated your life to ending slavery, and now you can't even talk about it on the floor. Are you ready to give up? And this is what he said. Duty is ours, results belong to God. My friends, we have been called to stand firm on the truth of God's word. We have been called to be a light to the world, to be salt to the culture. How is this all going to play out? We know how in the end. When? We don't know. Will it happen in our lifetimes? I think it will. Not sure. But that doesn't matter. We have been called to be obedient, to follow God. And as we do, as we stand firm on His truth, we can do so with joy, with peace, and with the hope that only believers in Jesus Christ can have. And then Peter says, be prepared for those who ask you about the hope that's within you. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus once again. And I ask the Holy Spirit to come and to speak to us in this very moment. And have the freedom, Holy Spirit, to work here in our hearts and lives. I know many are anxious this morning, and some may be terribly anxious because they've never encountered a relationship with you. So, Father, I pray this morning in this final moments together that you would move in our midst as only you can do. Every head bowed, every eye closed this morning. I want to pray for you. First, I want to pray for those who would say, you know, I want to stand firm in this hour. I want to stand firm. If that's you, just slip up your hand. I want to pray for you. You want to stand firm in this moment of uncertainty, of anxiety, and just all that is occurring. You want to be a rock for your family, for your community. You want to stand firm that others would see in the world and want to know what's the source of your strength. Father, I pray for those who have their hands lifted this morning. Lord, may they stand firm on your word, on your truth. Lord, may you draw with them closer to you, a desire to spend time with you in prayer and studying your word. And may they experience a joy and a peace that they've never had before, going beyond what you've given them, that they would walk into a new experience. And Lord, it would be so evident that people would be asking, what's the source? Why are you so at peace? Why is joy overtaking you? And then, Lord, give them the boldness to share the truth. And put your hands down. I'm going to ask you all to stand with me for just a moment as we close. Just stand with me. You're here this morning, and you've never invited Jesus Christ into your heart to be your Lord and Savior. I'll tell you right now, if I didn't know Jesus, I would be anxious right now because he's coming back. And once he comes back, your opportunity to know him as Savior has ended. Everyone's going to declare him Lord, but only those who declare him Savior now and appeal to his grace will spend eternity with him. And if that's you this morning, I want to pray for you. In fact, all the believers, I want you to just go to pray right now. Bow your heads, pray. For those that need to know Jesus, if you're here this morning and you do not know him as your Lord and Savior, I want you to lift up your hand. I want to pray for you. Just slip up your hand right where you're at. I see that. Yes, I see that hand. Others, you need to know Jesus. This is the moment. Slip up your hand right where you are. And I want you to pray with me. I see that hand. Right there where you are, I just want you to pray with me. In fact, for those that lifted your hands, I want you to look at me. I just want you to look up here at me. I want you to pray, God in heaven, I realize I need a Savior. And I realize that Jesus is the one who died for me. And I ask you to forgive me of my sins and to come into my heart and to be my Savior and to be my Lord. And I declare by an act of my will from this day forward, by the power of the Holy Spirit, I will live for you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for saving me. Use me now for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer this morning as we are leaving, I want to invite you to come and meet with one of our prayer teachers, and we have a gift that we want to give to you. So if you'll just make your way down front here as folks are leaving, we want to pray with you and encourage you in this new walk. God bless you.
Oh, I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. If it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just the doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified.
Bless you, church. Hey, if you want to get more resources from Tony Perkins and FRC, please go to the courtyard. And if you need prayer, come on down to the front. Someone from our prayer team would love to meet with you. We'll see you back here on Wednesday night.